This week, Conflict Zone is in London at the headquarters of the Unite Trade Union, the biggest and most powerful backer of Britain's Labour Party and its leader, Jeremy Corbyn. And my guest is the union's General Secretary, Len McCluskey. To some, he's Red Len, hard left activist who wants to junk capitalism. To others, a trade union leader who simply wants to bring about a fairer and more equal Britain. What's the truth? Len McCluskey, welcome to Conflict Zone. Do you consider yourself to be a Marxist?
No. I wish I was sufficiently well-read and educated to be able to say that, but I've...
You like quoting Marx, though, don't you?
Oh, yeah, I like quoting lots of people. I've quoted Edmund Burke in the past, which is slightly different from Karl Marx.
But you're not advocating the abolition of capitalism?
No.
Its replacement with a classless communist society?
No, I'm not. I wish I had a magic wand to make the world a better place, but...
Is that the kind of better place you'd want for it?
I'd want a fairer world, a world that made it more equitable. I mean, just recently, I think it was Oxfam, produced two startling facts. Eight billionaires, eight single individuals, own more wealth than 50% of the planet. That's extraordinary.
I ask you about your political leanings because... A, you quote Marx a lot, but you're in the Labour movement. You've got plenty of other people. You've got John McDonnell, Shadow Chancellor, said it in a video soon after the financial crash. We've got to demand systemic change. Look, I'm straight. I'm honest with people. I'm a Marxist. So you're comfortable among people like that. You're comfortable with Jeremy Corbyn, who said our job is not to reform capitalism, it's to overthrow it. Do you not buy into those things? Overthrowing capitalism?
I'm perfectly comfortable with Jeremy and John, and both of them are effectively expressing your view that they'd like a better world, and I certainly would like a better Britain, a better Europe,
a better
world.
It's not just a better world they're talking about. They're talking about non-capitalist world. Yes, I mean, you keep saying the system isn't working,
well,
but you're very coy
isn't.
About what kind of system you'd like to replace it with.
Tim, I've been called lots of things. I've never been called coy before, so that's a first.
But we have. But the reality, we haven't had that.
The reality is that the system of capitalism is not working. You've only got to look around the world.
So you want to replace it?
I would love to replace it with a fairer system.
And what does that mean?
It means exactly
that. What kind of fairer system do you have in mind?
It means a more equitable system. Trying to.
It sounds as though you're dancing around.
I'm not dancing around. You're obviously trying to get me to say you'd have been happy for me to say that I was a Marxist.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry to disappoint you.
Well,
three questions so far have centered around that particular fact. I'm a socialist. I believe that socialism is a better form of economic and distributive political system than capitalism.
You feel you have a mandate for socialism? I mean, your election results at Unite this year were pretty poor, weren't you? You have a dwindling mandate and dwindling union membership.
Well, no.
You could argue the only direction this union is going is down, isn't it?
Well, far from it. I mean, I think you'll find that Unite is perhaps the most prominent trade union in Britain. It's the most powerful Britain. And people see it as being
at the
forefront.
But your mandate is dwindling, your personal mandate. 4 years ago, you were elected by less than 10% of Unite's members on a turnout of 15.2%. This year, turnout was down to 12%, and your share was pretty much cut in half, down to 5.4%.
Yes, but the reality, of course, is that we've changed the number of people who can vote. In the initial figures you're quoting, there was a significant number of retired members who had a vote at that particular time. That's since been changed.
It could also be argued that it's because you're failing to inspire the members.
You and other
leaders of trade
unions.
Well,
Tim, we would like ballots at workplace. That's where unions are. Unions organise themselves in the workplace. And if we had workplace ballots for general secretaries, for example, we'd get the same type of turnouts that we get for our shop stewards and representatives.
But 90% from 144,000 votes to 59,000.
You're missing a particular important factor, if you don't mind me saying.
Those figures aren't important.
No, what is important is winning. I've been elected three times. I'm very proud and very humble by that. But I've been elected three times as the leader of Britain and Ireland's largest union and most powerful.
In 1979, there were 13 million people who were members of a trade union. Last year, the figure had plummeted to just over 6 million. In 2015, with you firmly ensconced as boss of Unite, the union membership recorded its largest annual fall since 1995. They weren't exactly cheering you in the aisles, were they, Lynn McCluskey?
Well, again, your figures, unfortunately, your researchers haven't done their job as well as they should have. The reality, of course...
Those figures are wrong?
The figures are wrong because, unfortunately, when Unite and was formed, Amicus and TNG came together, the figures that were reflected at that time were wrong. What we did when I became General Secretary is we flushed out the membership. There was a lot of non-members recorded. And so that's precisely why. Now, if you look at your figures, if the researchers have done their job, you'll find that our membership started to increase the following years. And that's precisely what we're seeking to do, but you also need to understand...
The total membership of trade unions was down from 24.7% in 2015 to 23.5%
last year. Yes, but the percentage, that's right. But what are you trying to say, that unions are in decline?
Yeah, well, they are in decline.
Well, you're wrong. The reality, of course, is...
At a time when people need them.
You are wrong, because, of course, the reality is we're dealing with an economy that has now got huge numbers of self-employed, zero-hour agency labours, the so-called gig economy, the type of individuals who frankly need a union but are afraid to join a union. They are constantly put under pressure not to join.
So why are you unable to appeal to these people?
It's not a question of appealing. It's because it's because of the laws that exist.
You said they should be running for the entrances and they're running for the exits.
The climate that exists within Britain means that effectively they are afraid to join trade unions. But if the point of your question is that unions are less effective now or not relevant, then that just simply isn't true.
You had three highly respected former union bosses who told you before the vote in the Unite Union that it was time you moved on. Roger Lyons, Bill Morris, Margaret Prosser, former president of the Trade Union Congress, all of them said they needed a union leadership that was first and foremost there for the members.
And I'm delighted.
Clearly, to them, you weren't there for the members.
And I'm delighted I didn't have their support.
There comes a time, they said, when all trade union officials must make way for their successor generation, and we believe that time has come for Len McCluskey.
Unfortunately, they didn't have sufficient influence in the union. They've sold out to our members a long time ago. And I was delighted not to have their personal support.
They were also very upset, Margaret Prosser, about the way you suspended your chief rival for the leadership, Gerard Coyne, before the ballots had even been counted. Were you so afraid he might win?
Well, I never suspended him. Again, you researched.
Well, the union did.
The union did. Well, you'll have to...
Yeah, and your general secretary...
No, I wasn't the general secretary at the time. The acting general secretary acted on behalf of the union and the executive.
Now, are you happy that a challenger was suspended even before the count had begun?
No, I wasn't happy with the whole of the election
campaign. No, I know that, but are you happy with the way that he was suspended and then dismissed?
Why would I be happy at someone being suspended or dismissed? It means that something wrong has happened. I regret the fact that something wrong happened during the campaign.
I'm talking about the way Unite handled it.
No, I have no criticism.
That here was a man.
I have no criticism whatsoever.
He was served for 28 years and he was sent an email to say he'd been fired.
I have no criticism whatsoever with Unite. And as you know, that's the subject of legal proceedings. But I wasn't party to either the dismissal or the suspension of Gerard Coyne.
But this is a union which is supposed to protect workers' rights, and after 28 years, Gerard Coyne gets sent an email and said goodbye. So you're dismissed.
When you say sent an email, there was an investigation.
I
there
know.
Was a charge, there was an investigation,
yeah.
And there was a procedure.
And six out of seven charges fell away.
And an appeal. Yeah. Yes, well, yeah. So the reality is there's a procedure.
Yeah, there was
Don't
a procedure.
Try.
There
Tim,
was a procedure,
Tim, please,
but he got, just got
please,
an email
Tim,
telling him
Tim,
he was out.
You do yourself a disservice by trying to produce an image that says he received an email, he received a text. That's not true. The union went through its process. process like any employer does. And I wasn't part of that process. I had no input in that process. That process was dealt with in accordance with the rules of the...
But you began shouting about a plot by a cabal of MPs on the right of the party
to
undermine you.
I never shouted.
You talked about it.
I never
You said they turned the election into a proxy war against Corbyn. You accused your chief rival of a shameful campaign of lies, innuendos and smears.
Well, that's correct. That's exactly right.
But you're the person who's consistently complained about the treatment that you and Jeremy Corbyn and the left have got in the media, the constant talk about the left coming under heavy enemy fire, the constant bias of
and
the right-wing press.
And your point is what?
But it seems from all these accusations that you give as good as you get, don't you?
Well, do you want me to stand there and take the punches on the chin? What I said was very clear that, unfortunately, and this has happened on a number of occasions, we might get onto some of it when we talk about the Labour Party, there are people within the establishment, both the right-wing establishment and the Labour Party establishment, who have constantly sought to have a proxy war against Corbyn. My election.
Oh, they were just against you as General Secretary.
But the reality,
why shouldn't they be against you as General Secretary?
No problem with that, but the reality is they weren't. It wasn't about me. It wasn't about me. It was a proxy war.
How do you know it was a proxy
Because
war?
It's very evident. Read all of the stuff around.
You also claim that the security service, MI5, was trying to undermine Jeremy Corbyn. You told The Guardian that when the files on what is happening now are opened in 2046, the role of the intelligence services in smearing Jeremy Corbyn would come to light.
And?
You haven't got one shred of evidence to back that up,
Tim,
have you?
You have a reputation.
Have you?
You have a reputation of being a sophisticated journalist around the world.
Oh, come on, Len McCluskey.
Around the world.
You don't have one piece of evidence.
Around the world. And if you believe for one second that security forces, with your experience, are not involved in these type of political machinations.
You have not one shred
of
evidence,
Of course I don't.
So it was a smear. It was a smear on the security services.
Well, shame on me for smearing the security forces. The security forces...
You don't think they have a credible threat to the way of life?
The history of the security forces in the British Labour movement has been nothing short of disgraceful and despicable.
Do you seriously think, Len McCluskey, that the British security services don't have a more credible threat to the British way of life these days than Jeremy Corbyn? They're dealing with terrorist threats.
I never said.
Think they've got time for this?
I never involved myself in this particular court.
Smearing Jeremy Corbyn. You really don't think they have better things to do these days?
Of course they've got better things to do. But if you seriously believe that the establishment are not interested in a Jeremy Corbyn and the movement that's taking place in the Labour Party, then you're not the man I think you are.
But what a lot of enemies you seem to have acquired. Labour MPs who weren't loyal enough to Corbyn. Tom Watson, Labour's deputy leader, you accused him of skullduggery, smears and secret plots. Then there's the right-wing press, the security services. Is there a bit of paranoia creeping into this union, Len McCluskey?
Not in the slightest. You say that I've acquired many enemies.
You've seen conspiracies at every bus
stop. It's not a conspiracy. You've only got to read the media to know that, of course, anybody who stands up and fights for working people will be challenged by the right-wing media who control the nation's thought process. That's precisely what's happened.
Carwyn Jones, Labour's leader in Wales, referred to Labour as a paranoid political movement more concerned with rooting out traitors than it is with the economy, security and happiness of our country. The booing, the hissing, the name-calling, the trolling, the threats. It has to stop, he said. It has to stop. This is what you've turned this Labour movement into.
Well, that's utter...
Booing, hissing, name-calling, trolling, threats.
That's utter nonsense. The point you're making is absolute nonsense.
Why is it nonsense? It comes from Labour's leader in Wales.
And he makes the point at the time that there were people who were opposed to the challenge against Corbyn. I don't remember Carwyn coming out defending Corbyn when he was being constantly attacked and stabbed in the back. I mean, this is nonsense what you're talking about.
Really?
At the moment. Utter nonsense.
Like the accusations of anti-Semitism in Labour, which you dismissed and said were being used by Corbyn's opponents within Labour to undermine his leadership.
Absolutely.
That was nonsense too.
Oh, hang on. That is exact nonsense. I've been a member, unlike you, of the Labour Party for 47 years. I've never been at a single meeting where there was anti-Semitism, because had there have been, not only I, but others at the meetings would have reacted and thrown those individuals out. That was more mood music being designed to undermine Corbyn.
So the Board of Deputies of British Jews got it completely
wrong, did they?
They know nothing. They know nothing.
It's not a question of they know nothing. There's a distinction between whether you want to be critical of the Israeli government and anti-Semitism. Jews for Labour didn't get it wrong. Many, many left-wing Jews...
Chief Rabbi got it wrong, did he?
He got it wrong, and I wrote to him seeking a meeting.
The old party committee of MPs, you know, that accused Corbyn of institutional anti-Semitism.
Tim, this is extraordinary. I don't know whether you've been out the country for too long. Do you know what's been happening for the last two or three years in the Labour Party? Do you know the type of attacks that Jeremy Corbyn has had to put up with day in, day out?
What about attacks on Louise Ellman or Ruth Smith or, you know, Joanna Baxter and her colleagues on the Labour's National Executive Committee?
Absolutely disgraceful. And anybody who's found to be involved in any anti-Semitic behaviour is dealt with by the Labour Party procedures and condemned out of hand by Jeremy Corbyn.
That's why the campaign against anti-Semitism called Labour's inquiry a vague, meaningless whitewash.
The reality is that the campaign that was launched, any opportunity, we might come on to issues like Venezuela, any little thing that gives people the opportunity to try and undermine Corbyn and paint the Labour Party as some form of misogynist, anti-Semitic organisation is used by these people. It's absolutely wrong. And there are Jewish organisations and Jewish left comrades in Israel who are condemning the type of attacks and vilification of the Labour Party.
Let me say this to you.
People like Jeremy Corbyn and me have been out on the streets physically fighting the racists and the anti-Semites. So I won't take any lessons whatsoever from the right-wing media or right-wing Labour MPs who've never lifted a finger in their lives to oppose discrimination.
Let's talk about Brexit. Your Labour Party has a new policy on Brexit. Unlike the Conservative government, Labour now wants to stay in the single market and the European Customs Union for a transition period. No limit given on how long that would be. How is that not a betrayal of the referendum result?
Well, I'm not sure about no limit how long that would be. As far as I'm concerned, my union fought in favour of remaining in Europe. But the truth of the matter is, of course, the vote has been taken and Britain needs to leave the European Union. As far as we're concerned, it's a question of defending jobs, workers' rights, investment.
But this new policy, how does that do
that? The new policy, Labour fought the election, I thought, very well. I thought Corbyn presented a position in the last election which spoke for the whole of the nation, both the 52% and the 48%.
But he's gone back on that, because he said, it's only weeks ago, he said that under a Labour government, Brexit would mean leaving the single market.
And I think that will happen. That is still Labour's policy, as I understand it. Yes,
seems to have changed, because he's holding out the possibility that if there are some changes in Europe, this could be permanent, staying in the single market and the customs union. It's not the question
of staying in the single market or the customs union. It's getting the benefits of a tariff-free single market and the customs union. Now, that's what David Davis promised us. Labour's job at the moment is to hold the government to account because they're in an absolute mess. Our colleagues over in Europe tell us that information from their governments tell them that nobody knows what Britain's looking for or wanting at the moment. So what Labour has to do is to try and steady the ship.
And there isn't going to be another U-turn, and we're going to find that Brexit is junked and we're staying in the European Union.
From the Labour Party.
Well, we've already had one big U-turn.
From the Labour Party, I don't think there's any chance of that. And I don't think we've had a U-turn at all on Brexit. We've had a Labour Party and Jeremy Corbyn arguing up and down the length and breadth of the country that he wants to defend jobs. People may have voted to be out of Europe. They didn't vote to be out of their jobs. And so what is required now is a skillful way of trying to negotiate where jobs are protected, whilst at the same time dealing with the real concerns about the free movement of labour, which undoubtedly had a negative effect in the referendum campaign. And Labour is the only party I've heard so far that puts forward policies dealing with both of those issues.
You mentioned Venezuela. Let's just take a look. You've been a staunch supporter of both the late Hugo Chavez and the current leader, Nicolas Maduro. Your website says Venezuela has one of the most democratic and progressive governments in the world. What's puzzling is the degree to which you've completely ignored the massive human rights violations that have been extensively documented in the country under both leaders. Why is that?
Well, first of all, I think what's currently happening in Venezuela is a concern for all of us. And what we're seeking to do is obviously try to make certain that the real news, the full extent of what's happening and the full picture is understood.
You're not giving the full picture at all. You're giving pro-government propaganda, aren't you?
We are in favour of human rights, and we've called upon the Venezuelan government and indeed the Venezuelan Solidarity Committee to promote the concept. But here's an interesting fact. The idea that suddenly we're supposed to believe that the right-wing press in the UK, that the United States, that right-wing...
I'm talking about Human Rights Watch.
So am I.
You're quite happy to quote when you agree with them.
So am I, and that's why we will continue to quote them. But what we won't do...
You won't quote them on Venezuela, though?
Yes, absolutely we will. Yes, absolutely we will.
I don't see you quoting them on Venezuela.
Absolutely we will.
I don't see you quoting Amnesty International UN High Commissioner for Human Rights or the European Parliament. I don't see you quoting any of those.
What we won't do is jump on the bandwagon that's being whipped up by the hysteria of the right wing.
Well, the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights does know, and on the 8th of August, they reported a picture.
And we condemn, Tim, we condemn any human rights violations.
Where did you condemn the widespread and systematic use? The widespread and systematic use of excessive force against demonstrators in Venezuela.
Exclusive. I'm condemning any form of attacks on human rights now. But remember,
By the government
and by
its security forces.
Remember, we've got
doesn't appear in any of your union literature.
Got a whole history of Latin America being attacked. Workers. I didn't hear you or anybody else attacking Colombia when thousands of trade unionists.
We're talking about you taking a stand.
The stand is simple. We defend human rights.
Really?
In Venezuela.
By saying it has one
Colombia,
of the most democratic and progressive governments in the world.
It did under Chavez. It did too. Of course, it was a cultural...
Human Rights Watch said under Chavez it was characterised by a dramatic concentration of power and open disregard for basic human rights guarantees.
Did it also not say that the advance in literacy, in tackling the extreme poverty, was to be commended?
The erosion of human rights protections has given the government free rein to intimidate, censor, and prosecute Venezuelans who criticise the president. And you were absolutely silent on that.
But what I'm saying to you is, what you have to look
at...
What you have to look at is Venezuela before Chavez. That's right. What you have to look at is the immense poverty, the attacks on trade unions, the rip-off of ordinary working people before Chavez came along. What you're trying to present now is that suddenly Venezuela has fallen apart and there are undoubted problems that will be exacerbated by what the Americans have done with their embargo and what people are attempting to whip up. Again, another example internally in the UK of people wanting a proxy on people watching. What I've just said to you, I condemn actions by the Venezuelan government and by opposition forces.
So stick it on your website.
We won't be given lessons by people who've been against working people all across the world for ever.
And you United don't think it's States against working right people? Wing.
I've just said yes.
So Len McCluskey is going to start reporting these things now, is he?
I'm going to deal with what we've always dealt with, which is the defence of working people and the elimination of the disgraceful poverty and inequality that existed and still exists right throughout Latin America. And when the right-wing establishment throughout the world, led by the USA, were attacking working people and propping up dictatorships, we were opposing the United States. And we're not going to take any lessons from them now, but we will undoubtedly condemn the type of issues that have been reported by Amnesty International and other recognized organizations.
Thanks very much for being on Conflict Zone.